I am so grateful to have the privilege and honor of having Richard Hester here to work on my piano for this concert. I have enjoyed knowing him for over 30 years through the small world of fortepiano builders and players. He has attended the program for master piano builders at the Fachschule für Musikinstrumentenbau in Ludwigsburg, Germany. Since 1980, Richard has been a builder of Viennese fortepianos after Anton Walter from the Mozart and Beethoven period. A frequent lecturer on historical piano topics, he has been a music instrument curator with the music department of the State University at Albany and has received numerous research grants to photograph and make technical drawings of original instruments in European collections. Richard Hester is also in great demand as a modern piano concert tuner and technician in the Albany area. Richard, thank you. Thank you for coming here to give us your wisdom on the differences between these two wonderful instruments on stage.
Thank you very much, Monica and Jiayan. It's a rare situation where we actually are going to closely talk about two instruments that they're not that far apart in time. You might think that they are, but I'm going to try to give you a quick outline. The Steinway we think of as a modern piano, but it's really a reproduction of where the modern piano had evolved by about 1875. So there are little tiny enhancements, but they're very, very small, very micro in this instrument between the present modern Steinway concert grand and one from about 1870-75. So if we're going to use that date for what we call a modern piano, then this represents a Viennese style instrument from Graf. Konrad Graf is the builder, and those dates would be in the teens, like 1814-15 through his last work about 1840. So we're talking about early mid 19th century and later 19th century. And the evolution of the piano had many stages. There were earlier stages of this Viennese type. Mozart and Beethoven knew that. Schubert moves into the next period of time. So that's why you're hearing Schubert today. So what are the differences? In gross terms, this piano has more wire in it, a wider range, but has larger wire in it. And that allows the piano to be louder and play to bigger concert halls as the 19th century was learning about selling tickets and getting more people to come in. The English were very good at that. And that's why Haydn went to London and Beethoven tried his whole life and never quite got there. So if you made the instrument more robust, you could make greater sound and fill bigger halls, and the commercial aspect was pretty clear. It was done in different ways, how to make the piano more robust. The English had evolved keyboard instruments in the 18th century from the harpsichord framework, and they enhanced the harpsichord framework, but soon gave up because they knew about Watt and engines and metal. And things that were very differently durable because of the materials. So the English changed to a metal structure, whereas metal structure to hold the tension required for the strings. And the Viennese and the Germans generally didn't like the concept that you had metal in a musical instrument. It was okay for the post horn and the bugle on the battlefield, but their sensibilities were different. So they engineered the necessary structure in a different way. This piano, if we took it apart and looked inside, we'd find wood, but the placement of the wood and the fact that it's not just one solid piece of wood going in a structural direction, it probably is laminated, one on top of the other. So it's still wood, and it's still gonna have a sound response like wood. but it acts very differently. If you jump back 20 years from this piano and look at more of the Mozart period, the early Beethoven period, those instruments have also a wood structure, but it tends to be solid pieces placed exactly where they need to be. And so what does the structure have to do with the sound? An instrument accumulates sound, or it puts its sound out and it blooms. It goes up into the air, you hear it. And if there's metal in the frame, it takes a bigger energy input to cause that to happen. So if you have a metal frame, larger hammers, thicker soundboards, all of this rises, and then when it rises, it does this big thing and takes longer for that to dissipate. Whereas the wood frame instrument, this one, kind of at the early 19th century, a little bit different from the Mozart and Beethoven period, it's trying to accumulate sound, but it doesn't do it the same way. It blooms quickly, and it's gone again. So if you look at the writing of Mozart and Beethoven, Schubert too, you see the work in the composition that requires these distinctions, and these instruments automatically do some of that for you. Also, when you have a heavy instrument that has a heavy structure in it, the structure tends to make it more homogeneous. So this is, in comparison sound-wise, this is almost like an organ. And that sounds a strange word to use in describing a piano. But the sound comes up and it stays there for a long time. And whereas this one, it presents the sound and you can hear the little differences between the tenor and the alto registers. And then about the time you're ready to focus on it, it's gone. And that causes audience to have maybe a little difference in alertness for that. That was just part of the times. The structure means a whole lot, and even though it's only a portion of the middle part of the century, it's enormous. Sometimes I'll have to do work on a Viennese piano in the morning and then another concert hall in the afternoon, and when I sit down with the modern one, it's a lot of material. But you can create very interesting cloud-like effects. Think of jazz ballads and things that are just really sexy kinds of sound. You can pile up the sound. That's not to say you can't play Debussy here and have something interesting too, and you should try that. Each has advantages, and it's just fun to explore. Listen, though, a lot on the Viennese piano for these distinctions between the registers. I don't want to talk too long here, but we've got a couple of action models here. This one on your left is a Steinway action model, and you can see there's a lot of pieces here. Actually, it's interesting to know, we think of the Steinways came in about 1853 to the United States, and they established a business in New York and then later again in Hamburg. It's a French action. That's an Erard invention from about 1805, and then modified again about 1895, or excuse me, 1819. So what this part here that lifts the hammer, this repetition, is absolutely a French model. If you look that up, you can just visually see all the parts. And so why did they do that? They needed this mechanism here to lift a heavier hammer, and you had to have a heavier hammer if you had bigger wires. So all these things are quite logical. Also, as the Germans say, the Spieltiefe, the depth of play. When you push down on the surface here, we have to go 10 and a half or 11 millimeters, and we have, in the Steinway, we're pushing down, it depends, in the treble where the hammers are small, maybe about 46 grams to get this to go down. And in the bass, maybe 56. These things can vary depending on how the piano is regulated. But with the Viennese, it's going to be like 22 grams to make that go down. 22, and you don't have to go 11 millimeters, how about 4.5? So that means in terms of technique, you could get this stuff next to your side. You don't need to be flapping that too much. So it's a finger technique, but see that comes out of the harpsichord and the clavichord in the 450 years before that. And that we should also say that you have the piano here, and the piano was invented in Italy around 1700, but it's still, we have a far less time than the whole keyboard era before that. So everything comes out of something else. And with the Viennese one, I wanted to say you had about 4.5 millimeters and you have 22 grams to move that. So you can just imagine the difference in technique. And I think this is a tough one. Some people do it more easily than others. But if you've grown up on the modern piano with these kind of resistances, you have to kind of self-analyze or have some help from people who do this to know how to navigate that. So what else have I failed to say about these two things? Well, I'll say a little bit about that. These two are pretty close. By the mid-19th century, the pitch is kind of around 435, 430. And so you're not going to hear great differences here. Although when we tune these, the 19th century was still concerned with the beauty of certain keys. Now, by the middle 19th century, they're writing in all of the different keys, whereas in the Renaissance period, the Baroque period, they didn't usually use keys with 4, 5, and 6 sharps or flats. So the difference between these two on stage, I don't think you're going to hear, it's very slight. But if you're playing in F, G, C, any of those that have 1, 2, 3 sharps or flats, you're going to have slightly slower beating thirds. And that, if one can recognize those and you go back into the Baroque period, those thirds are going to even be more beautiful. But the price you pay in balancing the elements of the temperament are such that that's going to make your F sharp and your keys with 5 and 6 sharps and flats even more difficult. So all I would say here is we have a little bit of a difference between these two. The pitch here is 435, the pitch here is probably 440, 441. So you won't hear much pitch difference. If you demonstrated the key of F major and C major, and then played B major and F sharp major, you would hear a little difference here. If the temperament hasn't wandered, and temperaments tend to do that after you tune them and play a little on them. So I think that be by all I need to say for the moment. Ask me a question if you need to later, if something comes to mind. Thank you.
Jiayan and I will play some short samples from our duets, both on the Steinway and then on the Groff, in a minute. But before we do that, I would like to give a short tribute to Malcolm Bilson. I would like to acknowledge Malcolm. He was a teacher and mentor for both of us. And in fact, he was the person who introduced us. Malcolm has been the key contributor to the restoration of the fortepiano to the concert stage and to fresh recordings of the mainstream repertory. He is a kind of musical grandfather to all of us who continue to love and play and learn from these instruments. So now we'll play for you.
So we will start by playing the opening of the Allegro in A minor for four hands. First on the Steinway, then on the Groff. Thank you.
better.
Well, we'll continue with the beginning of the rondo in A major, then we'll go to the graph. I think that's better.
Thank you. That's what I asked. Yeah. I almost wish you could ask people what they think.
It's always interesting to do this kind of experiment. I want to say a few words first, because as what we just heard from Richard, he introduced us to these two instruments in such a wonderful way. Yeah, this is better. I just want to say that as performers, I think for us, what we attuned for is the tone of the instrument. Based on what Richard just said, the concern with this kind of instrument is about the volume, it's about the power, and it's also about the homogeneous of the timbre throughout the instrument. That across the registers, we hear more or less the same timbre. It's regulated, it's designed that way. That it's the job, it's the responsibility of the pianist to create the tonal palette on this instrument, on this tool. Whereas with this instrument, at least for me, it seems that each register has a speaking personality in it, that somehow there's more of a speaking tone because of the design of the instrument, because of the quick attack of the smaller hammers, the leather hammers, that the tone is, it has this directness, yet such warmth in it, that when we just demonstrated with the forehand music, all these characters, they manifest in such a way that makes the comparison very striking.
It's fascinating for me to do this experiment right now. I've spent the last period of time with the Graf, and I played the Steinway Concert Grand yesterday for the first time in a long time, and I feel I should apologize that I don't think I did justice to the Steinway, because I'm so tuned to the other way of playing. There's so much more sound, and you have to handle it differently and readjust. And one thing on the modern Steinway, the bass is huge, and on this music, you can't let it all the way out. We could. Do you want to demonstrate the length of the notes? Just playing one note on each piano.
Just one note.
Maybe. Yeah.
Four.
Steinway would have lasted longer. You could have gone for coffee if he had
used the pedal.
I stopped short.
Normally we probably would be using the pedal much more often on the Steinway. Absolutely. I have to say, playing these duets on the Graf, I am having so much fun. I feel like sometimes the notes I'm playing are a human voice. That they just, and I have in the past played with singers with the Graf, and sometimes I couldn't tell whether I was hearing the piano or a singer. I mean, it's just a extraordinary, especially in the sort of baritone range of the piano. Do you want to say more? Or?
Something we could add, talking about the difference in the voices between the two. The Steinway needs a large hammer, and by the 1850s or 60s, they began to use a felt material, because prior to that, like this piano has, and the ones before it, they started with just a small wooden mallet, and they covered it with one or sometimes two. But the Graf would have slightly bigger strings in it, needed a bigger hammer. So it's slightly bigger than what Beethoven, that instead of having just one or two layers of leather, it had three, maybe four. Well, the problem, as you add more leathers, you get these interesting character differences, but it's for the manufacturer, it's difficult because you're trying to control the tension in the hammer so that when it hits the string and comes away from the string, it excites, but it dampens for a microsecond too. It dampens the string and falls away. Well, that gets to be difficult to control and to manufacture four, five, six layers of leather. So that's the reason as pianos became heavier structures, metal structures, and bigger wire, that you had to use felt. Felt you can manipulate in the slurry of water. You can make the little natural wool fibers that are interlocking. You can make them denser or less dense. So if you have a great big concert piano, you'll have a greater, more dense felt layer than you would for a smaller upright piano or something. But at any rate, those are two separate things that are going on between these two instruments.
Can I talk about the pedals?
Okay, maybe, I don't know how well you can see, but this instrument has four pedals. That one has three. Mostly people use the two outer pedals, the damper pedal and the so-called una corda pedal. This piano has, of course, a damper pedal, just like the modern piano, and it does the same thing. If you play a chord and pick up the keys, the sound stops, and that also happens on the modern piano as well. If you use the damper pedal, the sound will continue. So it creates a whole different special effect. On this piano, because there is a bigger decay of the notes, you can sometimes use special effects of playing longer passages with the dampers up, which Beethoven possibly wanted in the Moonlight Sonata first adagio movement. And actually, I use that effect in the Moments Musicaux at one point. And Jiayan sometimes does that too when he plays Beethoven, I noticed. The leftmost pedal is a shift pedal, just like the leftmost pedal on the modern piano. On the modern piano, the whole keyboard in action shifts, and you get a softer part of the hammer. The hammers get worn in by playing, and so you get a more muted and soft sound. On this piano, and this doesn't work on every model piano, but on this one, this is called the una corda pedal, because if I put it all the way down, let's see. I'm on one string, I think, and then I can bring it halfway up and get two, and then get three. And this is an effect that Beethoven asked for in some of his late sonatas, and the fourth piano concerto, Una, Due, Tre, Quarte. That, of course, is not possible on the modern piano. And truthfully, Richard can tell me if this is right, many early pianos have that pedal, but they don't really do one, two, and three strings. Am I right?
Yes. It depends on how accurately you regulate these things. But there's quite a lot of thought that the pianos from this period and earlier, they're much more about all the gradations of quiet. When they were played full out, they made quite enough sound for the people of their day. I mean, you had cobblestone streets that made noise, and there were various sounds to contend with, but the full volume here was quite enough. So they had these moderator stops with different thicknesses of text tiles that went between the strings.
Right, thank you. This piano has a single moderator, there's a piece of cloth that comes between the hammer and the string, so you get a more muted sound. Okay? And then this piano has one of my favorite of all pedals, the double moderator. And the double moderator puts two pieces of cloth between the strings. So here is single moderator. And I believe, I don't know whether Jiayan would argue with me or not, but when Schubert writes triple piano or pianissimo, I think he wants the double moderator, and it creates this ethereal, far-off sound. So when I see the pianissimo, I use the double moderator. And you will hear plenty of examples of double moderator in all of our playing in this concert. Now, what I can do is, I can show you an example from the C sharp minor Moments Musicaux that I will play.
Right along with this, there's an interesting little sidebar. We find a lot of this period, but a little earlier, where the lids don't have any varnish on the underside. And that could mean that they didn't put the lids up. They were quite satisfied with the amount of sound they had. I'm not sure if it had to do with projection, but it seems to fall somewhere in the idea of modification of sound to small nuances on the quiet end. So their ears were sensitive differently than ours.
Okay. I may give this back to you. Oh, I see what you're going to do. And talk also. So I need close enough. So. First, I want to play a passage from the trio of the C sharp minor Moments Musicaux, using the una corda pedal, and then as I crescendo, I go to due and then tre corde and back to una corda, and then I continue using single moderator briefly. So I'll just play that. So the una corda is useful if you're going from very soft and then gradually bringing the sound up. There's a beautiful example for double moderator at the end of this piece, the main A section of the piece. I think you're all familiar with. He finishes, returns the A section, and has a little coda at the end. Triple piano for two measures, going back to the trio as if reminiscent of something. And then Jiayan taught me this. It goes back to the present, to the norm. So I'll just play the coda of this piece and then turn everything over to Jiayan.
there's some wonder with some of the originals that are seem to be suggesting that with singers especially, the ethereal quality of a very thin moderator, even thinner than this, might have been a very enhancing thing to be accompanying in a room where you know you didn't need much and you wanted a really special effect. So all of these different gradations of moderator are make us wonder and give us beautiful things to listen to.
Yeah, I really enjoyed what Richard said about this fascination for soft sound, because I was just listening this way, this close to the instrument. I really enjoyed it. I would never do that with an instrument of that size. So, yes, so we are talking about, in a sense, different mentalities.
There's that, I think Dan Ritter is the painter, and it's from 1840s, and it shows Franz Liszt playing the piano, and Georges Sand is in the audience, and they're all hanging. Yeah, he's right. You wouldn't put your hearing quite so close with a modern instrument.
And as we are talking about pedals, instruments at that time, if the owner of the instrument has enough money, they can put in as many pedals as they want. It's like devices. It's like nowadays when we buy an iPhone, you know, 256 gigabytes versus 128 gigabytes. That's what they did. I mean, we have instrument that has a Janissary bell, because in Vienna at the time, they had a fascination for Turkish music. So this piano doesn't have that, but we can find originals and replicas that could have that special effect. And some of them have these so-called bassoon stops. That's a piece of cloth that put on the bass string that could create this kind of nasal sound. Yeah, so so
Jiayan.
We could have pianos that have six pedals or more.
I think we're running out of time, and you should treat us to the Schubert G flat impromptu opus 90, number 3 on the Graf.
Yes. Yes, so as the concluding section for our segment, I will play the complete impromptu in G flat major by Schubert that you just heard at the beginning of the hour. Before I go there, I would like to make a reflection of some sort. You know, we can imagine that we are all in Vienna instead of in Northampton. That we are in the city of Vienna. We are enjoying our time in the beautiful city where Schubert and so many others lived. And you ask me for a ride from the Hofburg to the Schönbrunn. And I, as your friend, present you with two options. On the left, we have the state-of-the-art Mercedes. And on my right, we have a most gorgeous horse carriage with the most beautiful white horse. As can be expected, the ride on the Mercedes would take about a quarter of an hour. You will get there safely, smoothly, and maybe a little bit boring, but you will get there. And very quickly. And on the horse carriage, you know, it would take a little longer than that, maybe half an hour, let's say. And you know, we will take the same route as directed by Google Map. And you know, the ride could be a little bumpier. we can smell the horse, maybe. But I hope that we can enjoy the ride, regardless whether we are on the Mercedes or on the horse carriage. And I think it's with this attitude in mind, we as practitioners and as listeners cherish the experience of the Mercedes and the horse carriage, and hopefully the Steinway piano of our time and the Graf piano and its replicas. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
one more piece for you, A Short March by Schubert for pianoforte.